Professor Dave again, let's check out some tests.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just learned about convergent series, which are ones where the sum of all the terms in the series is some finite number. But it can often be difficult to calculate the precise value of the sum, and there are only certain special cases where we can easily get the sum using simple computation. Luckily, there are special tricks we can use to help us find sums, or at least estimate them, and one such trick is called the integral test. Take something like the sum of 1 over n squared from 1 to infinity, giving us 1 over 1 squared, plus 1 over 2 squared, plus 1 over 3 squared, and so forth. And we can easily plot these points graphically. If we also show the function y equals 1 over x squared, essentially connecting the dots, we recognize that this is the precise example we looked at when we learned about improper integrals, and we know the area under the curve over this infinite interval is actually finite. Therefore, we shouldn't be surprised to learn that this similar-looking series is convergent, especially since the sequence 1 over n squared does go to 0 as n approaches infinity. In fact, we can actually use this function to estimate the sum of the series. Let's make some rectangles under the curve, each with a base of 1 and a height equal to the value of the function at the right endpoint of the interval. The area of each rectangle is equal to one of the terms in the series, because this rectangle has an area of 1 over 2 squared, and the second term in the series is 1 over 2 squared. This rectangle has an area of 1 over 3 squared, and the third term in the series is 1 over 3 squared. So every rectangle all the way to infinity has a corresponding term in the series, and we are leaving out only the first term, 1. The sum of the areas of these rectangles is pretty close to being the area under the curve, which we know is just the integral of the function. So the sum of the series will be approximately equal to 1, to account for the first term in the series that has no corresponding rectangle, plus this improper integral, which approximates the sum of all the rectangle areas and therefore accounts for the rest of the terms in the series. We know how to evaluate the integral. We just find the antiderivative, which is negative 1 over x. And we evaluate at infinity and then at 1, which gives us 0 minus negative 1, or positive 1. The 1 from before plus the 1 from the integral equals 2. So that's our estimate for this sum. Now, we know that the rectangles don't quite fill up the total area, as there are some empty spaces. So the integral is bigger than what we really wanted, and therefore the actual value for the sum of the series must be a little less than 2. But we've still done a pretty good job at getting some information about the series. How can we summarize this technique in a general way? We can say that if we have some function, f, that is positive, continuous, and decreasing from 1 to infinity, and we also have a sequence that is derived from this function, in other words, a sub n equals f of n, then the series that can be formed from this sequence from 1 to infinity will be convergent only if the corresponding improper integral is convergent. If the integral is divergent, the series will be divergent. If the series is indeed convergent, then we can also estimate its sum by calculating the improper integral in some way that is similar to the example we just performed. And that is the essence of the integral test. Let's just mention a few important truths that can be found by applying the integral test. Any series in the form of 1 over n raised to some exponent is called a P-series. This includes our first example, 1 over n squared. As it happens, any p series will be convergent if p is greater than 1, and it will be divergent if p is less than or equal to 1. So if we have 1 over n cubed, it will converge. If we have 1 over the cube root of n, or 1 over n to the 1/3, it will diverge. There is one more test we can learn that will be an important technique, and it is called the comparison test. With this technique, we will take some series and compare it with a similar series that we know to be convergent or divergent. For example, say we are looking at the series 1 over the quantity 2 to the n plus 1, from 1 to infinity. This looks like it could be tricky to assess, but what if we compare it to a simpler series, 1 over 2 to the n? This is a simple geometric series, and as we have already seen, the fraction gets smaller and smaller as the exponent gets larger and larger. So the sequence converges to zero, and as we saw in the previous tutorial, this is indeed a convergent series with a sum that is equal to 1. If we know that this series converges, what can we say about the original one? Well, this plus 1 term in the denominator means that each term in this series must be smaller than each corresponding term in the other series. And if every term is smaller, then this series must also converge, and the sum of this series must also be less than 1. So we aren't calculating the precise sum with the comparison test, but it is a useful tool for determining whether a series is convergent or divergent. If every term in a series is smaller than each corresponding term in another series that is known to be convergent, then it too must be convergent, as we just saw. On the other hand, if every term in a series is larger than each corresponding term in another series that is known to be divergent, then it too must be divergent. Let's just do one example to make sure we can apply this. Take the series 5 over the quantity 2n squared plus 4n plus 3. We can simplify this to 5 over 2n squared to use the comparison test. What do we know about this simpler series? Well, we can manipulate series just like we do integrals, and 5 halves is a constant that can be pulled outside of the sum, as doing this is essentially like factoring 5 halves out of all the infinite terms in the series. Then we are left with something very familiar, and we know that this series is convergent. Our original series has terms that must be smaller than the terms in this series, because there is more in the denominator, and n is always positive, so the fraction is always smaller than if those terms weren't there. Therefore, this series is also convergent, and its sum must be less than that of the one we are comparing it to. Now that we have the basics down for assessing whether a series is convergent or divergent, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.